Now back to the discussion of drawback. So by now we should be familiar that we have primarily three types of drawback that we are dealing with: manufacturing unused merchandise and rejected merchandise. Manufacturing and unused merchandise have direct identification type and substitution type. And manufacturing drawback is found under section, then title 19 USC code 1313, A for direct identification and B for substitution. Unused is found under the 1313, 19 USC 1313, paragraph J. Also, J1 is direct identification, J2 substitution. And rejected merchandise is found under 1313C, 19 USC 1313C. And the reason we want to associate the drawback type with its statutory provision is because customs examiners are asking questions sometimes by referencing the United States Code provisions only, or sometimes asking questions on the type of drawback and expecting you to know the particular United States Code association with it. All right, so that's for the drawback types. Now, so we stopped at the completion of drawback claims, and a substantial departure from that has been made as a part of the Trade Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act was to change the statute of limitations for filing drawback. So now it's 5 years from the date of importation. We discussed that date of importation is a term of art, and it is not necessarily the same as the date of entry. Now, the old rules say 3 years after the date of exportation or destruction of claim merchandise, that would be the time for filing a drawback claim. And of course, filing a drawback claim is achieved through filing this particular form called CBP form 7551, where you identify the relevant product, how it was entered, how much duties have been paid, etc., etc. So this is CBP form 7551 is one of those type of drawback forms, drawback entry filing forms, which we should get accustomed to. So since this old rules are still part of the regulations and they may be changed anytime, but we are learning with the focus of keeping in mind the new rules, but also keeping in mind the old rules, because customs can test you on the old ones as well, as they have done here. So in here, the one of the exam question tests you on this 3 year rule after the date of exportation and destruction. Remember, the new rule is 5 years from the date of importation, right? So using the old rule to complete the drawback claim with all required documents shall be filed within 3 years after the date of exportation and destruction, testing you on this rule. The next question, also testing you on the three-year rule: importer A, importer shorts into the United States in 2011. Shorts remain in the warehouse, and importer A finds a foreign buyer in September 2011. So from July to September, they were in the warehouse. Nothing has been done. So we're talking about unused merchandise, right? The shorts were exported on October 15, 2011. Within how many years must the drawback claim be filed from the date of export? Again, under the old rule, it would be 5 years. Under the new rule, it would be 5 years from the date of importation. Not date of export, but date of importation. Next. Also another example on a question testing you on the old rule, because again, customs examiners, they do like to ask you questions on statute of limitations, on this 10-day rule, 10-day working day rule, for example, the 15-day rule for filing entry, 10-day rule for filing, for paying duties. They 180-day rule for filing a protest. So customs, in other words, customs examiners, they do like those days. And they do like to know whether or not those days are working days or business days, or whether those days are the calendar days, which includes holidays and weekends. All right, so no later than October 15th, 2005, because the point here is the date of export under the old rule. And it would be 3 years from the date of export, so that would be the starting countdown when you begin counting those 3 years, and this day will be the day when you stop counting for those days. All right, calculation of drawback claims, as we see, the importer is required to fill this out, and part of this is the requirement of calculating how much duty does customs owe. Of course, customs reserves the right to verify this, but the groundwork, the calculation work, the mathematics should be done by the drawback claimant. And we already discussed who the drawback claimant is. It can be pretty much any party, as long as there is a chain of custody and assignment of rights. But there are also the defaults, and generally the default party is the exporter or destroyer of the product. Or in case of rejected merchandise, it is the importer. All right. So let's see. We are. Let me pull up the PDF file. All right. So. Drawback claimants are required to correctly calculate the amount of drawback due. So here customs examiners are asking you right on point. Blank is R is required to correctly calculate the amount of drawback due. And here the focus is on drawback claimants. USPPI, United States Principal Party of Interest, refers to a responsible party whomever files the export documentation. Here, since customs broker exam is primarily import driven, the drawback is kind of like a exception within this trend. You do not hear much about this guy right here, USPPI, but it's kind of like importer of record. Importer of record notion within the customs business, right, within the world of import, this would be the almost like an exporter of record buzzword for that particular party who takes responsibility. The freight forwarder, of course, is the guy who moves freight. An import specialist is a person within the customs and border protection hierarchy, who it's generally refers to a personnel which review and audit the entry and check the appropriate documentation and make sure that the flow of products through the borders is legitimate. The United States Department of Treasury, it is somewhat still in the game in the world of customs. Not as much as it used to be prior to the Homeland Security Act of 2002, which placed Customs and Border Protection under the umbrella of the Department of Homeland Security. All right, so now we get to the merchandise processing fee and how it is apportioned. All right, so before we get to the apportionment, there are some things we need to really review. And that review concerns the MPF regulation, which we should be familiar with. It is found under part 23, part 24, section 23, fees for processing merchandise, or also known as merchandise processing fee. So here is some things that we need to note. So while fees are generally, and we're interested in this portion, right? The paragraph B portion. So while fees are generally collected for formal entries, there is different schedule for informal entries, and there is a bunch of exceptions. The general MPF general rule, MPF, merchandise processing fee, general rule, is at least $25 of collection, or if not $25, then 0.3464% also can be expressed as 0.003464, and the maximum, so this is maximum, is 485. So this is the minimum, this is the maximum, and this is in between. So this is a merchandise processing fee assessment. It comes from the section 24-23, and it says it must not exceed 485 per entry, and cannot be less than $25. Essentially, the idea behind the merchandise processing fee is that there is a cost associated with customs administrative functions, and this customs administrative functions must be covered by merchandise processing fee. So, having said that, since now we know that the maximum is 485, we know that some things, some merchandise can, if you use the percentage calculations, you can exceed the 485. If you do not apportion, you can ask as a part of duty drawback to for more than 485. So what you need to do is, whenever you have a merchandise export, right, you are not using the percentages, right? You know that the basic rule of drawback is you get 99% of duties and fees back. But what happens if those 99% assessment is covered by the specific ceiling? This is when duty apportionment comes into play. So what I suggest is take a look at one of the questions which have been recently tested by the CBP examiners, and to see how it plays out in the real world. All right, so we have this question here, I think it's best understood through demonstration. I have certain concerns with this particular question, but I'll explain it as we go along. So let's take a look. So based on the information below, what is the claimed amount for the merchandise processing fee on unused direct identification 1313J1 drawback claim? So 1313J1 is unused merchandise. It's one. Under old rules, there were limitations for the type of drawback for which you could claim MPF for, and unused merchandise drawback was one of the types of merchandise of drawbacks that could be that entitles one to collect merchandise MPF, merchandise processing fee duties, merchandise processing fees in addition to duties. The Trade Facilitation and Trade Enforcement Act, of course, eliminated. So now it would be really irrelevant which type of drawback was being utilized, because it entitles fees to all, it entitles MPF fee to all types of drawback. So it was relevant before. It is not as relevant today. They give us, customs examiners give us a breakdown list of items, and they tell us what this line item breakdown is attributed to. So you have imported merchandise, and they're asking to calculate the merchandise processing fee, and the merchandise processing fee here would be based on the following information. So you have 500 bicycles at $200 at $200 each. Then you have 500 spare parts at $175 per unit. The invoice, so you have bicycles and spare parts. You have invoice value at $1,187,500. And then you take out the non-dutiable charges, which is $2,500. And the total entered value would be $1,085. And the total MPF paid, merchandise processing fee paid, is 485, which is the maximum, which is the statutory maximum, which is the regulatory maximum under the 19 CFR 2323. So, and the MPF rate is 3464, which is the one that would be accessed. Except here is the thing: since you reached the ceiling, that's not the MPF rate that you are using. If you are, if you in fact hit the ceiling, and the exported merchandise for drawback purposes is 200 bicycles, so you imported, you brought in 500 and you took out, you exported 200. So the question is, how much you of how much of MPF can you claim? Can you claim back? We're not talking about the value of the duties. We're strictly focusing on merchandise processing fee. So this is when the question comes in: do I do apportionment or do I not do apportionment? What? How should I approach this? All right. So number one, with this particular breakdown, we first have to ask ourselves of what is covered by MPF, because we customs examiners provide us with two particular values, right? One, they provide us with 185 and 187.5. So one is the invoice value, one is the total entered value. So the question is, what is this, what is the MPF fee assessed on? Is it assessed on the total entered value, or is it assessed on 187 on the invoice value? So for that, I suggest that we go back to the regulation and we take a close look at what is being assessed how is merchandise processing fee being applied. So as we read the fee section, we see that the fee is due and payable to CBP by the importer of record on the merchandise at the time of the presentation of the entry summary. So with the CBP form 7501, you pay your duties, and at the same time you pay fees, of course. Is based on, and here is a punchline: value of merchandise is determined under USC 1401A.